Salutations, celestial sightseers. I'm David Fuller. Welcome to Eyes on the Sky. What's up this week? Above the plane of the Milky Way are the Virgo and Coma galaxy clusters, nestled in the Leo, Virgo, Coma, Berenices region of the sky. Looking ahead into morning hours, we can see where the Milky Way is, even if invisible naked eye. Look for the spout of the teapot in Sagittarius, then move towards Altair and Deneb here to peer into the plane of our own galaxy. Between those two areas is a portion of sky that contains some intermediate objects. Outside of the Milky Way, but not as far as the Virgo galaxies. It is the halo of globular clusters that orbit the Milky Way. These smaller than dwarf galaxies, but larger than open clusters objects, appear small to us because they are so much farther away than many of these sparkling open clusters we have observed recently. However, the concentration of stars at their cores results in them being some of the better objects to observe and find, especially from cities and suburban locations. So let's look for one. In the southeastern sky, about 2 to 3 hours after sunset, look for Arcturus, Saturn, and Spica. Using Arcturus and Saturn as the base, imagine a triangle with nearly equal sides, opposite from Spica. Unukalhai in the constellation Serpens is here, a 2.6 magnitude orange K-class star, 15 times the size of the Sun, that is also 1,500 degrees cooler than our star. It is fusing helium and carbon, having exhausted hydrogen fusion. It really does look quite orange, especially in smaller telescopes. We will use this star as our jump-off point to a globular cluster. And now this week's Dark Sky Fact. International Starry Night kicks off Starlight Week in August when the Perseid meteor shower peaks, but you can start registering events now at onestaratatime.org. In a finder scope or binoculars, Unukalhai is visible in the same view with the stars Epsilon and Lambda Serpentis. Draw a line from the fainter Lambda through Unukalhai and head in that direction about a full field of view to a fifth magnitude star, 10 Serpentis, here. Keep going just a bit further, and in that same area are 4, 5, and 6 Serpentis, all around fifth magnitude and forming sort of a crossbow shape. Move slightly from the center of the crossbow at 6 to the end of the arrow at 5, and there is Messier 5, a globular cluster, less than a third of a degree away. This is one of the oldest globular clusters surrounding the Milky Way at 13 billion years of age, and at 165 light years across, is one of the larger ones by sheer size. Observationally, it technically spans 23 arc minutes in our eyepieces, but practically speaking, most of us will visually only see about half that at 10 to 12 arc minutes of diameter, with a 6 arc minutes wide core. But compare that to how Saturn's rings appear in a telescope. Therefore, a medium to high magnification eyepiece, even in a small refractor, will show a dense, concentrated central region and a pretty large image size. With some dark adaptation and shielding from light trespass, perhaps even a few individual stars may be seen, as M5's brightest stars are 12.2 magnitude, at the edge of resolution in very small telescopes, but easily visible in 6-inch or larger instruments. In my 10-inch telescope, the individual stars make this look like a diamond dust cluster when set against a dark sky background. Okay, not quite like this Hubble Space Telescope picture, but you get the idea. On the 13th and 14th of this week, look for the Moon, Jupiter, and Venus lined up in the western evening sky just after sunset. That's all for this week. Keep your eyes on the sky and your outdoor lights aimed down so we can all see what's up. I'm David Fuller, wishing you clear and dark skies.